down. And thank you all for coming tonight. Welcome to the 14th Annual Cultural Studies Association Conference. We're really very, very delighted to open our intellectual gathering here at Villanova University. And on behalf of the governing board and the Cultural Studies Association membership at large, we would like to express my deep gratitude to the SCIES Committee and to the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences at Villanova University and for being gracious, generous hosts today and over the next couple of days. I also wish to express my gratitude towards the many people who have been supporting Cultural Studies and have made this particular conference, this particular intellectual gathering, reality. I would like initially to thank individual institutional members, the governing board, the executive committee, the administrative staff, the conference organizers, the chairs of our working groups, and many participants and exhibitors who will be attending and presenting at this conference. I also would like to give special thanks to Madame, the chair of the SCIES Committee, and his colleagues here at the University of Villanova, Miranda Joseph and Hilary Berg, co-chairs of the program committee, Paul Smith, vice president, soon to be president. Michelle Fessenfield, the administrative manager, who's worked really hard to help with this conference in short term. It's a success. Sean Johnson Andrews, treasurer of the association. Andrew Paul, the working group's coordinator. Stephanie Jones and Errol Rain, editors for Lateral. Hilary Burke and Jody Davis Pacheco, the maker space coordinators. And all the nameless people who helped and supported and helped make this intellectual gathering reality. Cultural studies is probably the best introduced as the politically committed and radically contextualist project to construct what one scholar, one cultural studies scholar recently called to construct a critical political history of the present. And I think the theme for this year's conference, Policing Crises Now, is a really timely theme for us that, in a sense, reasserts cultural studies and wavering and historical commitment and also desire to engage in critical intellectual work that aims and seeks to produce useful knowledge that people beyond the academy, within the academy, and beyond the academy could take and then do something bigger with to kind of help transform concrete historical and social conjunctures and formations. So this gathering provides all of us with the opportunity, the unique opportunity to systematically and rigorously deploy the critical tools and contextualist methodologies of cultural studies in order to examine, in this particular case, the relationship between capital, state, and culture at the current moment. Since we last met in Riverside, we've witnessed both the intensification of the police state and the renewed energy of culture and social movements as sites for challenging its power. This is probably best illustrated by the US Black Lives Matter protests, by the recent serial killings of an armed young man of color at the hands of the police that have led to the increased visibility of the repressive state and its apparatuses, and by the dialectical relationship amongst race, the economy, the law, and the state that determines all these developments. And I think the job of a robust, critical cultural studies that matters, cultural studies that can still claim to be a radical political and intellectual project, is to understand, study, explain, and help transform this state of affairs. So let's do that. Thank you. move safely to this evening's plenary. As present and intimate as the crisis seems to us now, we should reflect on the fact that this set of crises are as old as our attempts to construct social groupings. The crises are inherent to our refinement of the social contract, or social contracts. The social contract indicates the nature of policing and surveillance. In the world in which we live, in quotation marks, everyone from Jeremy Bentham to Michel Foucault, those before, in between, and after, have commented on how we police and how we are policed. The parameters are global, both geographically and conceptually. The intellectual affair of this comment, of this conference, illustrate that very fact. Culture and policing, the culture of policing, the policing of culture, the ways in which it rationalizes and creates a culture in which bodies are policed are fundamental to our discussions over the next few days. Art, culture, politics, and policing are crucial to these conceptualizations and to the possibilities for critiquing and indeed changing that culture and its policing. With that, it seems altogether fitting that we open this session of the 14th Annual Cultural Studies Association with an address and discussion by Professor Bernardine Evaristo. Professor Evaristo is a producer of culture, an author of 7 books of fiction and verse that explore the aspects of the African diaspora, including her most recent piece, Mr. Loverman. Her books include Laura, Blonde Roots, and The Emperor's Baby. She has numerous other writings and publications and is engaged in literary criticism and in writing for stage and BBC television and radio. 2 of her novels have been adapted for Radio 4, and she has edited and guest edited several publications in poetry and criticism. She's held several international fellowships and was a Montgomery Fellow at Dartmouth College in 2015. She's currently a professor of creative writing at Brunel University, London, and she has won many awards for her writing and criticism. She's been elected Fellow of the Royal Society of Literature, made a Fellow of the Royal Society of Arts, and she was appointed MBE in the Queen's Birthday Honors List in 2009. In some ways, Bernardine Evaristo illustrates the global nature of this particular crisis that we speak to. In another way of putting it, to evoke either Star Wars or a cultural critic, Bernardine Evaristo illustrates to us that the Empire can strike back, and that the Empire, in her case, will write back. Without further ado, Professor Bernardine Evaristo.
Thank you, Magan, and thank you very much to the Association for inviting me to give this talk. I hope to open up for discussion the ways in which British history, identity, and creativity are policed by the cultural gatekeepers. In my 2001 novel In Birth, The Emperor's Babe, I created a young black female protagonist, Zuleika, whose parents had traveled from ancient Nubia in the Sudan to settle in Roman London, Londinium, in 211 AD. 2,000 years ago, for a period of 400 years, Britain was a colony of the Roman Empire, a multicultural empire that extended as far west as Britannia, across Europe to the Middle East, and dropped down to cover the whole of North Africa. This empire was the precursor to the British Empire, that over 1,000 years later would begin a global domination that would eventually see it control a fifth of the world's population through its colonies and hold dominion over a quarter of the Earth's landmass. The Emperor's Babe was indebted to the book Staying Power, A History of Black People in Britain by Peter Fryer. He wrote, "There were Africans in Britain before the English came here. They were soldiers in the Roman Imperial Army." The soldiers Friar is referring to was a legion of Gauls who were stationed at Hadrian's Wall in the north of the country. It was in staying power that I also first discovered the black presence from the 1500s onwards, all of which is recorded and archived. Indeed, in the 1500s, there were so many blackamoors in Queen Elizabeth I's realm that she twice issued a warrant to have them banished, both times without success. To hear that this presence in Britain was so old was astonishing news to someone such as myself, who had been told, as we all were, that people of colour had only migrated to Britain in the 20th century. In time, I would discover that the policing of British history had effectively omitted any aspects of its past that did not collude with its narrative of itself as a historically white nation that was only now being sullied by the darkies arriving at its shores. It was my ambition with the Emperor's Bane to challenge this myth of black history that only began after the Second World War, when the British government sent a clarion call to its colonial subjects to relocate to the motherland, to restock its depleted workforce. This mass movement of immigrants, who began their new lives as alienated and unwelcome denizens, became known as the first generation, to which my Nigerian father belonged. For the first generation, who had been invited to Britain, the message was nonetheless soon broadcast loud and clear from the rooftops. You are alien to us, you don't belong here, we don't like you, go back to where you came from. This generation was the seedbed for subsequent British-born generations, as well as later immigrants, who now constitute a significant demographic in British society. Out of a current population of some 64 million people, 14% of us are defined as black, Asian, or mixed. The irony is, of course, that Britain as an island has long been settled by outsiders. The English are descended in parts from the Anglo-Saxons, comprised of various Germanic tribes who migrated there following the end of the Roman occupation in the 5th century. The name England, or England, translates into the land of the angels, from which Anglos derived. Britain's historical origins do not preclude, however, the kind of tribalism that rears its ugly head when there are differences of colour and culture that are automatically regarded as barriers to communication, as opposed to invitations to interact and learn from each other. It's the tribalism that rears its ugly head when people feel threatened by those who appear to be different to themselves, and when one group feels superior to another. In writing The Emperor's Babe, I was careful to ensure that my protagonist came from the Sudan and not Egypt. I wanted the reader to imagine a very dark-skinned black woman, as opposed to Hollywood's version of, say, Cleopatra, as played by the famous English Rose actress Elizabeth Taylor. However, my conceit was challenged by the curators at the Museum of London, where I carried out some of my Roman research. They argued that as there was no evidence for a black presence in Londinium, my story was unfounded. I countered that my assertion was not archaeological, but logical. Surely, as Rome extended into Africa, and the empire had, as we know, very good roads, and as Rome itself was a multicultural hub, there was every reason to believe that black people found their way to Londinium. The curators were not convinced, their perspective limited, in my opinion, by an inherited sense of Britishness and deep-rooted tribalism that overrode common sense. There might not have been any evidence at that stage, but they could not even entertain that it was plausible. In any case, I was, and always will be, utterly logical, in that, as a writer of fiction, I can imagine any kind of world, real and imagined, past or present, or, anachronistically, both. The problem is that the long history of people of colour in Britain has yet to fully challenge received notions of Britishness. Even its own slave history has until recently been obscured, partly because there was not a huge physical presence of slaves in the country itself. The drama series, Roots, first aired in the 1970s and broadcast to the world the history of slavery in America, which was eventually taught in British schools. Contemporaneously, British people remained ignorant about our own country's involvement in slavery, which was not taught in British schools until 2008, that is, 8 years ago. It was only during the national commemorations in 2007 of the bicentenary of the abolition of the Slave Trade Act in 1807 that it was felt that Britain was finally fessing up to its own role and culpability in the transatlantic slave trade. Britain was the largest, and for much of this period, the most dominant slave trading nation in the world. Filmmakers tend to celebrate the English hero abolitionists, as opposed to focus on the brute reality of how Britain perpetuated and benefited from slavery for centuries in the New World, and how slavery became the economic bedrock upon which Britain's prosperity was built. These days, most Brits are likely to have heard of Mary Seacole, the Jamaican nurse who in the 19th century opened the British Hotel during the Crimean War, offering food and nursing to wounded soldiers. In her time, she was as celebrated as Florence Nightingale. Her autobiography, The Wonderful Adventures of Mary Seacole in Many Lands, became a bestseller in her lifetime. However, she disappeared from history books until after her death in 1881. Until academics resurrected her reputation 100 years later. But most people will not have heard about the ancient presence of African Roman soldiers or the hundreds of years of settlement and intermarriage from the 1500s. Sometimes we artists get there first. The Emperor's Babe was a work of the imagination in which I created a playful, irreverent, anachronistic parallel universe where a black Roman London girl is married off to a rich Roman. She gets to hang out with her bezzy, a drag queen called Venus, who runs a drag bar called Mount Venus down by the docks. And she becomes lovers with the historically real African Roman emperor, Septimius Severus, when he comes to town. Severus was from Leptis Magna in what we now call Libya. Even though my heroine endures marriage to an older man, I didn't want to present her as a victim, but as a feisty and triumphant young woman in the universe within which she has to operate. My protagonist was never going to be a slave or serf, but she is someone of means. This often surprised readers who assumed she must hold a lowly position. They were imposing, or rather transposing, the much later anti-black racist ideology that developed to justify slavery and the subjugation of Africans by Europeans onto an ancient Roman society that was actually devoid of it. Years after my book was published, archaeology is finally catching up with the discovery of an African Roman presence that goes beyond the walls at Hadrian's Wall. Archaeologists have been re-examining Roman skeletons unearthed over a century ago, with their more sophisticated forensic techniques are detecting many more African origin people in Britain during the Roman era, including a rich African origin young woman known as the Ivory Bangle Lady. The response has been one of shock at her discovery, but doubly so because she was a high-status individual, as indicated by her stone sarcophagus and the richness of her grave goods. I hate to say I told you so, but I cannot help but gloat. So, British history is heterogeneous. Multiple cultures have infused our shores. Not only the earlier settlers from Angevin, Saxony, Jutland, Frisia, Rome, and Jess Africa, but also later settlers from the 1500s who came from virtually everywhere else on the planet too. Yet our national memory is amnesiac, and our collective identity continues to be predicated on a history that makes invisible the truths that do not fit neatly into the perspectives and timelines of a strongly policed official British history. Consequently, there is still a barrier to understanding that British history, and therefore identity, has been more inclusive of different races and cultures than has previously been admitted. Here is one example. 2 weeks ago, the BBC concluded its drama series, The Hollow Crown, with productions of the Shakespeare plays, Henry VI Parts 1 and 2, and Richard III. The British Nigerian actress, Sophie Okonedo, played the lead role in all three productions, that of the French woman, Margaret of Anjou, who became the wife of Henry VI and therefore the Queen of England. It was a bold step for the BBC to cast a black woman in such a role, and it is testament to its new commitment to representing diversity that such casting is considered conceivable. Needless to say, there was public dissension from some quarters at the casting of Okinedo as an English queen. They were countered by those who argued that it is called acting and she is playing a part. But the truth is that there was a black presence in Europe during this period too, and while the Queen was not known to be of colour, we seem to forget that the Iberian Peninsula was colonised by the Moors for 800 years until 1492, during Margaret's lifetime, and they also invaded Gaul. We forget that Gibraltar is only 8 miles from Morocco. We forget how close Africa is to Europe. Many Europeans probably have African ancestry and do not know it. Cross-racial casting is no longer considered new and daring in British theatre, which is an improvement on much of the 20th century, when theatre companies refused to cast black or Asian actors in period roles on the grounds that it would be historically inaccurate. That's not to say that this tendency to exclude is completely obliterated, as evidenced by Sir Trevor Nunn's production of The War of the Roses, a distillation of 4 Shakespeare history plays into one, last year. This caused a furore because he cast 22 white actors and no actors of colour. The Actors Union Equity stated, "To present this benchmark of British heritage in a way that effectively locks minorities out of the cultural picture literally flies in the face of the huge conversations taking place in British media at present, of the very real progress made in recent years to include diversity in our industry." Sir Trevor Nunn answered his critics by saying he had cast according to historical verisimilitude. Yet we all know that Mr. Shakespeare played glass fast and loose with the truth, creating, for example, an utterly venomous character in Richard III, who bore almost no relation to what is known about him from historical evidence. The point is that Sir Trevor Nunn, one of Britain's preeminent theatre directors, is incredibly powerful. He was the artistic director of the Royal Shakespeare Company for nearly 20 years and artistic director of the Royal National Theatre for 7 years. He is now artistic director of Theatre Royal Haymarket. He is still at the heart of the theatrical establishment. He is a gatekeeper, a policeman at the gates of theatre, and he is deeply tribal. His successor, Nicholas Heitner, was artistic director of the Royal National Theatre from 2003 to 2013. During this period, he mounted 206 productions on the main stages, of which only 15% were played by women, of which only 20 were 4 productions sole authored by women. This is still an improvement on his predecessors, the worst of whom was Sir Peter Hall, who produced 4 plays by women in 15 years at the National. In 2008, Rebecca Menkevich became the first living woman playwright to have a play performed on the Odeon, the largest stage of the Royal National Theatre in its then 45-year history. To my knowledge, the National Theatre has only ever staged 1 play by a black British female playwright, Winsome Pinnock. Let's turn to screen drama, which powerfully nurtures and polices the public imagination. It explores our sense of ourselves, our realities, our histories and identities. Its impact on our consciousness can be seismic. Its audiences can reach for multiple millions. For much of my life, people of colour have been too absent from it in Britain, and rarely in positions of power. This was recently brought to renewed public attention by one of our leading actors and comedians, Sir Lady Henry, who delivered a broadside to the film and television industry in 2014 at the lack of black and Asian representation in the sector. For example, in 2013, 99.82% of television comedy shows were made by white directors. And the annual top 100 theatre power list is usually comprised of 98% white people, the majority of whom are men. Why is this? My detractors will say that it's because women, people of colour, just aren't good enough. This is all nonsense, of course, but what we are dealing with is centuries of tradition and inherited entitlement, and an often invisible phalanx of resistance to changing the status quo. We are also dealing with women who were historically excluded from positions of influence, from leadership roles, from working while being married, women who were traditionally homemakers and mothers. We are also dealing with people of colour who have not traditionally been to the most elite schools and universities and have access to the networks that operate beneath the surface of power. The 1980s and 1990s saw a movement of many alternative arts groups, and at one point Britain had some 35 Black in Asian theatre companies. Aware that there was very little work for us in the industry, we took control and formed our own theatre companies. I myself co-founded Theatre of Black Women, Britain's first such company. Today there are about three of those companies remaining, and perhaps four artistic directors of colour of our leading theatres or companies. What happened? Public funding support was withdrawn, companies disbanded, people moved on, sometimes into the mainstream. We thought then that the battle was being won because many actors began to break through into visible positions in the arts. What we didn't realise was that there would be a barrier to us taking the helm in the mainstream, that what we were witnessing was a kind of window dressing. We would be the performers, but not the puppeteers. We didn't realise then that we would not become the next generation of ADs, chief execs, funding officers, and senior theatre and arts personnel who decide what kind of art is promoted, who decides on the nature of our culture. The gatekeepers, those who police entry to the arts, especially its upper echelons, are exceptionally talented at perpetuating their own status quo and, sorry to say, egos. And by that I mean that they promote the arts that speak to them, their tastes and notions of quality defined by their gender, race, education, cultural interests, and when they are being inclusive, their understanding of communities beyond their own. Their so-called objective evaluation of art is based on whether it is relatable to them. Many outsiders are resigned to this, to being assigned a peripheral, secondary status. I am not. The consequence of this cultural hegemony is that audiences are too easily denied arts that are not defined by the establishment. Artists are denied the equality of opportunity that leads to lifelong careers and artistic freedom. Is it no wonder that so many Black actors take flight for here, for America, where their careers take off? In literature, I have witnessed how the publishing gatekeepers opened up and then shut down access to publishing. The 1950s saw the emergence of Afro-Caribbean male writers who were published in the UK in some number. By the 1980s, most of these writers were, for various reasons, no longer publishing. For a decade, from the mid-90s onwards, British novelists of colour became fashionable, which was worrying at the time, because trends are just that, ephemeral. My fears were realised when most of the writers who came up with me slowly disappeared. Nor is there a new wave of novelists coming through. At the same time, I've noticed how the deceptive beast of tokenism and celebrating the exception makes this situation of crisis appear otherwise. I admit that I am one of the exceptions, in that I have had a relatively long career, at least for my demographic. My long-term publisher is Hamish Hamilton, the literary imprint of Penguin and Random House, and I count myself among the lucky few who are still publishing and working with superb editors who allow me complete artistic freedom. As one of a handful of such novelists who continue to publish, I am acutely aware of the wealth of stories that are missing from our bookshelves and from my younger generation's education and imagination. What will our legacy be from this era when so little literature is getting published? There are thousands of years of Black British history to be explored by artists before the Romans, after them, the Tudor period, Victorian Britain, now the future. But what happens is that those who do make it inside the citadel dare not speak out in case they are injected as cannon fodder over the turrets into the wilderness below, or they enjoy their positions of special privilege too much to want to speak out. And those who clamour at the walls are too easily unheard, ignored, swatted away. I feel it is my responsibility, from a position of relative privilege, to shout about it. 10 years ago, there were two Black female commissioning editors in British publishing. Now there are no senior Black editors in the major presses. Access to arts initiatives do spring up over the years, but they seem to function as box-ticking, tokenistic gestures. We are still not in positions of influence inside the publishing houses or producing, directing, and writing the screen, television, theatre dramas, or leading other arts organisations. So the industry sets the agenda, the media follows suit, academics too, to a certain degree, follow hot on the tails of the media, and thus the canon is constructed. New black-led publishing houses do spring up, but without private backing, they tend not to last long. And it's hard to be competitive in a publishing and news media industry that has a history and reputation that began operations, in some cases, such as the Times of London, in the 1700s, or Faber Publishers or Penguin over 80 years ago. Very little black British and British literature is taught in the UK, and there is only one degree course specialising in it in the entire world, the MA in Black British Writing, that is now 1 year old at Goldsmiths College, University of London. Some contemporary literature courses are known to have all white and sometimes nearly all male reading lists, even though the student body is often primarily female and sometimes quite brown. Europe's first Black Studies undergraduate degree was launched at Birmingham City University just 2 weeks ago. Since 2011, the Runnymede Trust and the Office of Higher Education Statistics Agency have collated the statistics on the UK professoriate. Out of a total of some 17,000 professors in British universities, a professor is the equivalent of a full professor in the US. 92.4% are white, 20% are female, but only 60 professors are black, of which only 17 professors are black women, of which I am one. You do the percentage stats on that one. I can't, I really can't. So, what is to be done? How can we move forwards? I've realised I've focused on fiction, but literary advocacy and activism in the poetry world has managed to make a difference. A 2006 Arts Council report that I initiated into the crisis situation for poets of colour in publishing revealed that under 1% of poetry books are by poets of colour. I subsequently initiated a mentoring scheme for talented poets of colour to be mentored by many of Britain's leading poets. As of 2016, 20 poets have thus far participated in the scheme, and it is already yielding great results, with over 80% of the poets having their own collections published, or due to be published. And to date, they have won or been nominated for over 40 awards, including winning some of Britain's top poetry prizes. This year's Sunday Times Young Writer of the Year Award went to one of our mentees, British Chinese poet Sarah Howe. Another of our alums, British Somali poet Orson Shearer, collaborated with Beyoncé on her recently released visual album, Lemonade. Her poems interlink all the song tracks on the album. Better still, last year the percentage of published books by British poets of colour went up to 6%. A new round of 10 poets has just now been selected for mentoring. The poets we have mentored have also been networked into the poetry scene because we realised that talent alone was not enough. They are now editing special issues of poetry magazines, touring the poetry circuit, judging prizes themselves, and teaching at universities. History has taught us that we need to keep the pressure up, keep enrolling new cohorts of poets into the programme so that they reach critical mass. We do not want one or two celebrated individuals who effectively obfuscate the fact that others are not getting published or are marginalised. We want scores of poets who are established, who become part of the establishment, who are at the centre of poetry in Britain. Today, we are hopeful that the tipping point is on the horizon. One of the challenges in Britain is that racism, or more palatably, for those who take personal rather than institutional offence, unconscious bias is not part of the national conversation. The conversation doesn't happen unless there is a racist murder, after which there is a national morally upright outcry that exposes and explores frontline racism, but avoids the more subtle, powerful, and pervasive discrimination that is ultimately more pernicious. There is also a conflict between perception and reality, the myth of a post-racial society versus a still systematically racist one. We live in a culture of self-congratulatory post-racism, and it's only when the statistics prove otherwise that there are temporary grumblings in the press. Moreover, the arts in Britain is too often undervalued if it falls outside of the parameters of certain codes, modes, aesthetics, experiences, histories, communities, and knowledge bases. Issues of race, culture, identity, gender, history, diversity, sexuality, inclusivity, and representation are consigned to the sidelines by the ruling elite, the gatekeepers. This also applies to art that tackles racism in Britain. The cultural elite approves of art that, for example, exposes America's injustices. For example, Claudia Rankine's deservedly celebrated poetry collection, Citizen, but it congratulates British writing by writers of colour that avoids racism. How many times have I heard a novel praised because it's not about racism? Usually by a critic or judge who, I imagine, has no idea what we write about but has made this unjust assumption. Now, perceptions of Africa through its literature have also been endorsed and shaped by the publishing gatekeepers who decide on what is published and applauded. In 2012, I chaired the Kane Prize for African Fiction, a prize that has helped revitalise the fortunes of African fiction since its inception in 1999, to the point where it became a new trend about 10 years ago. The previous three winners of this prize had won with what some call poverty porn stories. In this case, stories about brutalised children struggling to survive in a depraved version of Africa. I asked how a continent of 54 countries and over a billion people could be reduced to such a narrow trip, 3 years running. But these stories mirrored what publishers chose to publish at that time, and the media chose to champion. African fiction was in danger of mirroring the Western media's perceptions of and preoccupations with the continent. I had to persuade the jury against allowing one of these stories onto the shortlist. They didn't get it at first. They liked the story about tragic Nigerian children left to fend for themselves in a very dangerous situation on the streets. It was moving, heartbreaking, shocking, etc., etc. Of course it was. Put young children into endangered situations in fiction and you will have the reader on your side. I eventually did persuade them and the story was left off the list. It's not that these stories are not valid, but we need the full spectrum of narratives from an entire continent. The Brunel University African Poetry Prize is a project of mine designed to revolutionise the fortunes of African poetry, which a few years ago was hard to find on the literary landscape. Since 2011, working closely with Kwame Dawes of the African Poetry Book Fund at the University of Nebraska, who had then just begun to publish poetry collections by Africans and administer prizes, this began to change. Most of the poets shortlisted for my prize have subsequently been published by the African Poetry Book Fund's New Generation African Poets Chapbook series. This is the poet's first step towards publishing a full-length collection. 5 years on, these 21 poets are starting to make a name for themselves. They will, I hope, be in the vanguard of poets who are shaping the future of African poetry. Initiatives such as these, where we are proactive in making an intervention, are important and game-changing, but I firmly believe that we have to work from both outside and inside the citadel, and to keep the pressure up. If we don't, there's a hell of a lot of backsliding that happens. I also believe in quotas for the arts industries, especially that are accountable to the public, such as in the UK, the BBC, and Arts Council-funded arts organisations. Without quotas, liberal sentiment abounds, but little changes. The old boys' networks, the Oxbridge networks, continue as they've always done. In Britain, we need to establish our own arts projects and initiatives. It's happening already, even if they operate on a small scale, even if we feel we've been there before, which we have. It's better that we set up our own arts organisations, even if our work reaches a smaller audience, if the alternative is to not get our stories out there at all. We need to produce our art on our terms, as artists and cultural producers, as well as being influentially represented at all levels in the powerhouses of cultural production.
Thank you very much, Professor Barrister. So much to think about and meditate on. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Chichi Akoma. I'm an associate professor of English at Villanova. I'm also the director of the Africana Studies program. And on stage with me Professor Maurice Hall, Associate Professor and Chair of the Communications Department, also here at Villanova. And we are here on this stage to respond a little bit to what Mary has said. But more than one response to her address is also to invite you, members of the audience, to join in the conversation. So we are really very much interested in creating the space for a conversation to think about policing. As you can see, and as I hope you got from the address, we're thinking about policing in terms of gatekeeping. The ideas of citadels or bulwarks, you know, of cultural production that are set up in ways that, in fact, defy the realities, the kind of heterogeneous realities that make up our real world through the will to power. And so we'd like to engage that particular subject, you know, especially in the realms of cultural production as our principal emphasis. And so, to kick off that whole conversation, I'm inviting Professor Hall at this moment to offer his responses.
Thank you very much. So, I too was very moved by her comments, and they resonated with me on several levels. On several levels, and here's why. In part because, in some ways, we share some background. I was born in the UK, grew up there for about 7 years, went with my parents when they went back to Jamaica to live there. Moved back to the UK at a later age and then moved here to the United States. Even though I work largely in disciplinary communication, my professional career as an educator began teaching literature and working in theater for many years. So as I heard your people unfold, it made a lot of sense to me. And I also grew up at a time where we were told that the gold standard for literature, and the gold standard for writing and thinking, was the British literary canon. And so, as an educator, as a teacher, if you weren't able to teach Shakespeare, or if you weren't wrestling with the works of Shakespeare and the canon of the works beyond that, you were taken very seriously. Imagine my surprise when, in college, I discovered works like the work of George Lang. The essay, The Pleasures of Exile, I read at 18 and changed my life. His reinterpretation of The Tempest so excited and energized me. I was sitting in my room and I was incredibly excited. Because it began a process of rethinking that which had been instilled in me. I went on to be introduced to interesting works like Samuel Sellers, The Old Works, Very Lovelace, The Dragon Can't Dance. These are works of literature from American writers that, in many ways, going to Professor Cater's point, speak back to the empire, or write back to the empire, write and rewrite and reinterpret what has been said. Here's one thing I'd like to offer. From my perspective in the discipline of communication, we talk a lot about broad cultural discourses. Cultural discourses that position their subjects within them in ways that have them both positioned but also imprisoned. And that position is incredibly powerful. It's analogous in some ways to writers who talk about the gaze, right? The gaze, the sense that the subject is imprisoned within the look, the ideas of those who create them. Some years ago, I did a study on Jamaican managers in Jamaica. One of the things that was interesting are the ways in which these managers, positioned as they were within the discourse, the broader discourse of colonialism, so how you come to understand your country as a colonial, as a post-colonial context, and how you come to understand yourself as operating within that, had enormous impact on how they saw themselves, That was the impact of the choices they thought they could make. And therefore, that was the impact of how they chose, what strategies they chose to use to manage. This idea of being positioned within discourse, as we talk about communication, comes from communication scholars' sense that communication has revealed in talk, but also in social texts of different kinds, media, and other kinds of texts, are incredibly consequential and are not merely reflective, but are creative of, are enactive of, are enabling of, are constitutive of social reality in many respects. And as I heard in the talk, much of what struck me is the idea that there is a sort of racialized cultural discourse that has positioned both artists, has positioned how we understand not just what art is, but what Black creativity is, and whether or not Black body is capable of creativity, is capable of reflection, self-reflection, is capable of narrating its own situation in the context in which it finds itself. And as I heard your presentation, I heard you speaking back to the ways in which that is both created and reinforced through gatekeepers. But it's also, perhaps, I think this is a question that we can explore, whether artists themselves, like the teachers that I looked at, finding themselves positioned within these broader discourses, find limitations in the choices that they seek to make, or the choices that they think of as being available to them. I'll say this and then I'll stop with more questions. One, colleague and I, engaged in an ongoing study currently in Jamaica. This is a study that has us looking at Jamaican theater. And in the study of Jamaican theater, we're looking at theater as an artistic form that in Jamaica, for very specific reasons, largely to government policy, has been used as a tool of developing national identity and of building an identity post-colonialism. So theater and other art forms in Jamaica have been used very carefully by the government in the 1970s and the 1980s to develop a response to Jamaica being a colonial country, a post-colonial culture, that was meant in very specific ways to counter them. One of the things that we found is that while artists in Jamaica, largely in the 1950s and the 1960s, sort of embodied the ideal of what art meant as they understood it in the British context. So we imported the idea of the British pantomime. We sort of took the tropes and the ideas of the pantomime and we put it on stage, but reinterpreting it using Jamaican stories. But we sort of created a hybrid blend. We were that generation of artists was very protective of what it meant to do with theater. What theater was, how theater was meant to be understood. And a lot of those conventions lined up very nicely with what they learned in the artistic forms that were created to British culture. So we were creative within it, but we still very much existed within the norms that were bequeathed to us within the government. We also found that there's a new generation of artists that were insurgent. What we claim to call, what's called in Jamaica, Roots Theatre, a group of artists who unapologetically embraced a Black aesthetic and literally throughout, many of the conventions of theatre that had come to be accepted. Right? So for example, you walk into a production, and instead of finding that there was this artificial separation of the audience, the stage becomes its own imaginary world. The stage became a part of the audience. So you could see people walking across the room. During the performance, you could see people, as the performance was going on, doing things backstage that you normally would not see. And more than that, rather than having a fixed script, the artists play off of the audience with the kind of creative improvisation was quite exciting to see. So the performance that should have been, or maybe would have been built for 2 hours, last 3, could last 4 hours, depending on the improvised nature of the interaction with the audience. It was a really interesting phenomenon to see. We realized we took understood the conventions as they existed, but they were also very deliberate in their intents to disrupt, to blow these conventions apart, to create new theater forms that did not have any allegiances to the older forms that were there. I guess my takeaway using this example is the idea that the policing of culture, this positioning of black bodies within cultural norms and discourses, artistic, cultural, and otherwise, through media, through arts, through other kinds of social texts. It's very powerful, very real. And you spoke incredibly well to that. Hopefully there are also glimmers of hope in artistic forms, in elements of cultural production that are incredibly insurgent, that seek to challenge them, that seek to upend them, that seek to provide glimpses in much the way that writers like Lang, Selwyn, or Lovelace that seek to provide glimpses, ways of reinterpreting, rethinking, rescripting what that discourse is and how it is permeated, how it's understood. Alan and I said this recently, came back from Cape Town in South Africa and had an amazing conversation with some young people there. Another young woman, during our conversation, making a passionate argument about living in a country where she felt like she was not free to go and be where she wanted. That her every movement, she told the story, going to a particular server somewhere in the outskirts of Cape Town. And they were accosted by police. They were just walking around. This was a largely Southside black settlement. And the police accosted them simply because the black bodies were in a space where they weren't supposed to be. And she said, I'm tired of being in my own country and feeling as though I don't belong here. I'm tired of feeling as though I'm in my own country. And I have to apologize for where I go, for where I am, and for where I find myself. So I'm tired of it. She's an educator, and she sees the way of changing that as being involved in education and involved in politics. That gave me a lot of hope. Given the history of South Africa, it gave me a lot of hope. And it also spoke to the pervasiveness the ways in which this transcends and occurs throughout the diaspora. It's a conversation we could be having here in the United States with young people, in fact, are having in the United States with young people, here in the African American community. So it's multifaceted, it's pervasive, it's cause for concern, and yet there is, and we can talk about.
Because again, the key here is understanding these other narratives that, you know, of realities that are not being, you know, given full play. That are for all kinds of reasons, but mostly political and means to power, whoever wills the levers of power, you know, get to define what narratives are told. And then thinking about it on the other side, thinking about how some of these writings, you know, that are emerging in the 20th century, again, suddenly in our time, are trying to write against that kind of power, you know, coming against that, and finding new ways of expressing these realities. I was actually thinking about, with particular reference, to to the instance you gave about the King Prize, fiction, African Prize for Fiction, which, like you rightly pointed out, started in 1999 and now has become one of the very prestigious prizes in African literature, fiction writing that we know of. And the idea, when you point out that particular peculiar experience you had when you had to say, all right, we've heard enough of this kind of narrative, or at least not enough of it, but as much as a continent of 54 countries or so, I shouldn't and can't be defined by this one narrative of child soldiers or extraordinary hardship. And the like, that there is more, Chimamanda chose a balance of stories. The desire, the need for a balance of stories. But I was also thinking about, yes, that is, there's much to be said about that. But thinking about policing of cultures, I'm also thinking about that. Returning to Africa, I'm thinking about this other dimension to this idea of policy that is still informing the realities of many parts of that continent. There's something going on lately in places like Nigeria, Ghana, Kenya, Uganda, where we have a powerful, group of, powerful groups, mainly coming from the religious sector, who are invariably, especially say Christianity sector, who have now been coming so much against many African festivals, many African cultural practices because they are heathenish, they are pagan, they are devilish. They are literally demonized as acts that do not reflect what should be considered Christian values. And so you now have a kind of a coming against, of practices that you would think are traditional to many of these African societies. So there are those. And then, of course, the one that is very much more, we are all more familiar with in Nigeria is the specter of Boko Haram, a group that literally, name literally means anything Western is Haram, is abominable, is not acceptable. So now here comes another kind of, another level of resistance, another level of policing, in a very literal sense as a way of culture, but a culture that is being, that is coming from, again, the very particular kind of hegemonic practices or spaces that these African writers are supposed to be coming against. In other words, there is a kind of reversal of the dynamic of the very cultural production of policing that we're talking about. And the question I have, or one of the things therefore that I'm thinking about is, what is the nature, what kind of nervous condition, as it were, to borrow from Fanon, what kind of nervous condition of the person, of the subject from this colonial or post-colonial side, what is the kind of nervous condition that can create the kind of circumstance or the kind of society where the very things, the very agents that have colonized, that have actually placed them in this kind of inferior situation, can invariably be the very tool they will use to suppress their own very understanding of self. And so it creates a kind of complexity, seems to me, to the very constituents of cultural production and invariably the very and the very consequence of existing those kinds of gatekeepers that many of these writers, that we're talking about, that we can be talking about, we are trying to create, open up the space, therefore, to think about both the ways in which, we have these very systematic ways by which our culture in their heterogeneous forms are policed. But also to think about the ways in which it's not always in one direction. that there are ways in which, again, evil discourses and practices that are policed are invariably redefining and making complex the very culture that is being defended, the one that is being advanced. And so, Evaristo and Paul, and thinking about what they have offered us, I would like to open the floor to your own comments, questions, or additions to what we've heard so far. Thank you. We do have microphones to the left and right, so you can walk up to either one of these and
making an argument for the worthlessness of identities and the marginalization of identities that are not white and British global. This is not entirely their own fault. Sometimes we participate in, we collude in these discourses. We also inhabit our respond to these discourses where we both absorb and reflect the destructive messages that are being made on us. And so I think it's very complicated. Yes, there are certain ways in which I think at universities, for example, what's called as a valid discipline or a valid area of study is certainly driven by what's been traditionally true. By what people have traditionally studied and by what their graduate schools have conferred and so forth and so on. And just because of shared numbers that often correlates with racial identity in many university perspectives. The question is whether or not those of us in the academy who may have the power to push against that don't collude with it also, and that's why it becomes so effective. So the policing is not just from the outside. Could it be that the policing is also from within? That we bought into these discourses, these ways of being and ways, that not only allow us to be limited, but limit even how we come to understand ourselves and what our identities are. And that, I think, is the genius of the colonial project. I'll say one last thing. When I do the studies of managers, my study of managers, one of the things that I've found is that how do you come to understand what something like leadership is, for example, right, in the 21st century, when the very concept of what leadership is has been defined for you by somebody else. And there is no way to develop alternative definitions that don't draw upon that. Where do you even begin? Because a world of meanings, a universe of meanings has been created. And when you live within those, how do you fight? How do you write? How do you create new meanings? When there is very little space to do so when everything else around you confirms what those meanings are. And so I think a lot of the tools that I use are a standard tool for the politics and so forth, like academia and so forth. But a lot of what happens is also that they're very powerful narratives that limit how we understand what black culture is and how it can be expressed, its validity. We have to absorb it as much as it's been put on us. I never forget reading Alan Bloom's Closing of the American Eye, and reading Make a Very, what he thought was a persuasive argument for why Toni Morrison could never be considered. And if you've not read that book, you should read it. It will infuriate you, but you should read it. And its essential argument is because she's not part of the university of Canada. And Canada. How do you fight against those things? That's so obvious.
I'll defer my response and take a remark. Yes. Indeed.
Yes.
This is a question for Professor Larissa. Thank you so much for your interesting speech and for starting us off at the conference. In today's publishing world, young adult fiction is one of the most profitable and also highly sort of contested, debated genres, with all sorts of discussions about what young readers should be exposed to, what they should be exposed to, and so on. I suppose I just have a general question for you about audience and how you think about your audience and how you think about your reading, your literature, and how you might reach a young audience and to what extent, material for young audiences should or shouldn't be any different for material in general readers. What do you feel that your books are available to all readers, or that you might write specifically for younger audiences?
Well, I write for adults. I have written one book called Hello Mum, which is a short novella
written in the voice of a 14-year-old boy who gets involved in a gang. And I guess I did have a sort of young audience in mind for that. And it does appeal to teenagers, especially teenage boys, read that book when they aren't even readers of fiction. We know that teenage boys don't read fiction. So that's the only book I've written that's really aimed at the younger market. In the UK, there is even less fiction published with minority characters by writers of colour. So there's a huge gap there. So that's very, very problematic. But generally, the wider question is about my audience or my readership. I don't really know. I know that mainly women read books in the UK. I don't know what it's like. Middle-aged, older women are big book readers. So perhaps that's my audience. I'm working on a new book at the moment, and in my head, for the first time, I actually am thinking of writing a book for women. Partly because of these issues that I have at the moment about who brokers our literature, who validates what we write, and often it feels as if some writers of colour are writing for a white audience or a Western audience. So in my head with this book, I am thinking to myself, I'm writing this for women. Let's see how that changes what I'm writing. And it's an interesting experience, but maybe that has a very broad reach, I'm not sure. But in terms of children's fiction, I'm not really an expert on it. I just know there isn't much of it, and I definitely write for an adult audience. Some of my material is very adult, so I wouldn't necessarily put it in front of children. and of course, children develop at different ages, so I do sometimes get adult, young children. Teenagers reading my work, they thought it very easily. But I have a question for you actually. You know, I just talked about British history and, you know, black presidents and so on. How does that sit with you as a predominantly, I imagine, American audience? What did you think when I was reading about 2,000 year African presidents and so on and so forth, and the statistics about our society today? Did it disrupt or challenge your notion of Britishness, or did you know it, or what?
I didn't know it.
So what did you think? Did you think, oh, this is interesting, or?
Sort of fascinating, and I appreciate the challenge to the dominant historical narrative. Saddened but not surprised when you were told that.
Yes. So what is your, have you been to the UK?
One time, a long time ago. Well, do we count Northern Ireland?
So what's your perception of Britishness or British people? Oh, anybody?
White.
If you haven't been there, it's white.
Of when you're walking in the streets of London, right? It's, I mean,
sign of telling you this is the current capital of the UK. So you could see the diversity on the street, you could see the diversity everywhere, except in academia. So the moment we moved into the conference rooms and we got to talk a little bit more about careers and about trajectories, it became very problematic that race was present almost by the same as the UK.
So it's very interesting, the UK, because certainly sort of at face value, we're a very integrated society. So we don't really have ghettos as such. You know, people live side by side. You'll get really, now London is an incredibly expensive city. You'll get properties worth literally tens of millions of pounds right next to council property. Council property is equivalent of public housing, literally in the same street. So it's a very integrated city. 60% of black men in Britain have white partners. And something like now about 40% of black women have white partners. So we're very integrated. You know, when I first, one of the first times I was in New York, I turned into 125th Street in Harlem, and I was so shocked that suddenly all the diversity I saw on Broadway had disappeared. I know it's changed now, but it had disappeared. Whereas you won't get that in the UK. We mix together, okay? My father came, he married a white woman, had mixed race kids. That was the sort of beginning of the kind of integration that now is the norm. You will see white women with brown babies everywhere, right? Especially in the big cities. But that still doesn't change the people who are controlling the society enough. It doesn't change it enough. I mean, those statistics I think are shocking. So that's the problem. It's about getting us into positions where we are in control of everything that we do as much as possible. So what you experience is the reality.
And actually, I do have a question. I'm from North Africa, and so the way I'm looking at these issues of race and class and gender and diversity in the U.S., you know, and I study, you know, my master's in the UK, so really different perspectives, but also different time frames. I was in the UK in the 80s, '90s. But the question I have is, what Europe is going through and what the U.S. is also experiencing is this backlash, right? So here we are talking about moving forward, where the gatekeepers are actually pushing us backwards. And so the question is not just how to keep the momentum going, but how not to reverse the little gains. I mean, they are significant, but nonetheless, how not to reverse what has already been achieved. So the challenge I feel is, even more so, as we think we are producing more knowledge that's troubling the gatekeepers. So the question becomes, what kind of activism, what kind of strategies, you know, are appropriate for the kinds of resistance that we have? Some of it is visible and some is masked by political correctness.
Yeah, I agree. So we have a political party called UKIP in the UK, and they've actually set the agenda for Britain to leave, you know, to have a referendum, which is happening very shortly, to decide whether or not we're going to leave the EU. And their big agenda is really immigration. You know, they are very, you know, they're treading on very thin ice in terms of being slightly fascistic. So if we do leave the EU, it would be a boost to their political power, which is extremely worrying, because at the moment they're a very minority political party. And so we have been able to push them away. But actually, we leave the EU, and it will be a sign that the British public, because the big issue for lots of British people is immigration, whether the economic side, economic refugees or political refugees or whatever, it will be a sign that we're regressing even more than we are at the moment. And that's deeply worrying. So you have Trump, right? And then we have this kind of move to isolationism in the UK as well, which is very worrying, because we have advanced so much in many ways, and we don't want to regress. But that seems to be what happens.
I have a question. What happened to this? When I lived in the UK in the 80s, there were some of those trends that you mentioned, mixed race matters and so on. felt as though there was no clear mechanism by which people of color recognized the centers of power in the UK. Because those had been so deeply entrenched for generations. Oxford, India, government. It felt like that privilege was such that it was quite extraordinary.
I think people do on an individual basis, and that's it.
So there is progress.
There is some progress, yes. We have lots of politicians of colour in Parliament. We didn't have that in the 80s. They were like four. Yes.
I was thinking about reflecting on your address. There's a measure of singularity to the resistance narrative that you offer. You know, it comes by way of convincing other jurors about expanding their choice of votes to shortlist or select, setting up a new enterprise in order to address a need. And I'm just wondering then, is there a way of how, what are the kinds of ways that would be more collective, that would maybe reach to a more systematic, that would get to say the heart of the matter or the system itself? What are the kinds of possibilities by way of something more collective?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that's something we have to look at very seriously. But because we don't have the people in academia, for example, America is very different. I don't know how many, 80 million people of color in this country.
I don't know what that is.
You have a huge intellectual body of people who have the kind of organizing power that we don't really have in the UK. So when I say there's 17 black women professors, I mean, that is just outrageous. So, but certainly community organizing, that's what we used to do. That's what we did in the 70s and 80s, and I feel perhaps we have to get this move to that. But I find that I can get things done easier if I just go and do them.
Yeah.
There's also sometimes you can get held back by community activity and organization.
All right, we'll take the last question. I'm very much sensitive to time.
Okay, it's a very good question. I was very impressed by all that you have done to promote black poets and black writers, etc. And you ended with a call to create our own institutions. And Maurice, I think, made a call to experiment with the poetry and with the literature. So my question is about the link between these two things, like what kind of institutions
some ways has connected young people across continents through music and through social media in ways that were astonishing. And in traveling around South Africa, one of the things that I found was that a lot of young people on social media are connecting with each other and are having these very vibrant conversations about how to change and upend and undo these very traditional institutions. And the link that connects them has been music, has been their shared love of music and their shared love of these musical forms. And it sounds like reggae and dancehall in particular have been very powerful media through which this conversation has continued. It's interesting, it's surprising, and she argues that Thomas argues that it constitutes sort of a form of transnationalism that hasn't been, she says, studied fully enough, but that can be enormously consequential, both culturally, perhaps politically.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harrison.